The Center for Latin American Studies at Berkeley is what we call an organized research unit. It pulls together about 85 faculty from across the campus, many graduate students and departments from bioengineering to the law school. And it looks at issues related to Latin America and related to the relationship of the United States and Latin America. We went to Detroit because Stan Ovshinsky and Ovshinsky Innovation, the company he now heads, are located in that area. Stan Ovshinsky is one of the great scientific minds of the last 100 years. There are many people in the alternative energy universe, gifted scientists, gifted technologists, but I think he combines that with a deep social vision. He's brilliant at science, but he wants science to change the world. At first glance, the Center for Latin American Studies and renewable energy seem like very different areas. In fact, they're one and the same. We've got three pivotal issues that are out there. One is certainly global warming. The consequences are irreversible. It demands action and will be very damaging to virtually every country. Second, energy independence, but it goes beyond energy independence. We're looking at the geopolitics of oil, meaning there are wars being fought where oil is a central issue. And finally, jobs. In Latin America, in many countries, it means an issue of development as well as jobs. In the US today, it means jobs and a broad prosperity. How do you bring these three issues together?
I set up the company because we felt that pollution, climate change gases, and wars over oil were going to be a tremendously important problem, and that utilizing anything but zero emission is not going to solve it.
We went on a rather remarkable journey in Detroit with a small group of people from Latin America and the United States, and a remarkably diverse group of people. They range from Cuauhtémoc Cárdenas, the former mayor and presidential candidate in Mexico, the mayor of Mexico City, to Christopher Edley, the dean of the law school at UC Berkeley. David Bonnier, the former Democratic leader of the U.S. House of Representatives, was there. So we had a broad group of people there. The unifying principle originally was something that the Center for Latin American Studies and a Mexican university, ITAM, have put together called the U.S.-Mexico Futures Forum. We understood in those discussions, sitting in Mexico City, the urgency of this issue, wars being fought over oil, climate change threatening irreversible destruction, a need for new industry development and jobs. Costa Rica wants to be carbon neutral by 2020. That's a remarkable goal. It's a tough challenge, but they're really addressing these issues. How? Mexico is trying to address energy issues in some important new ways. Brazil has moved in some world-leading directions in this area. The question was, where do we take this? What might we look at that would give us a sense not of what's theoretically possible, but what's possible tomorrow?
When we started Ryerson, I started ECD in January 1st, 1916. We wanted to have science and technology solve societal problems. And we knew that in order to make something that's useful, it has to be low cost, it has to be simple, it has to be something that is unbreakable and robust, and therefore it had to use new ideas.
Stan Ovshinsky not only developed a new area of physics based on amorphous materials named after him called ovonics, but he took it to that next step. He produced a technology capable of manufacturing and diffusing these materials in a wide range of areas, including solar material. Stan Ovshinsky wants to harness the sun. He starts with hydrogen, creates what he calls the hydrogen economy. He's done pioneering work on hydrogen and hydrogen storage. Stan has developed prototypes that are very manufacturable today of hydrogen vehicles. Batteries, the nickel metal hydride battery.
For the last 1.5 million years, there's been the fossil fuel age. Now, there is a new age being born, and that does not depend on fossil fuel. Hydrogen is the ultimate fuel, the ultimate energy source. It started with the creation of the universe. It is the most common element in the universe. It powers the sun. It has no pollution, has no climate change gases. You can get it from many, many sources so that you really have no dependence upon oil and have any of the effects that are now causing all the problems, for example, the global warming.
To me, this is a cathedral. I mean, this is beautiful. I get chills up my back. There's 3 rolls, 1.5 miles here, and on the other side is symmetrical. Feeds automatically through this entire machine.
9 miles and 6 tons in one complete production run on the machine. When I first started, that was considered impossible.
And you don't have to build a special roof.
30 megawatts a year, 30 million watts a year. This was the beginning of the revolution. It's not the end of it. What I want is to have one machine make a gigawatt, not serial machines where you have tremendous costs and billions of dollars. And you have to wait for a long time. And the cost then to the consumer is still going to be significant. But if you do it for a gigawatt, you're cheaper than coal.
You remember how those solar panels, how big they used to be? Look at this. I want everybody to look at this. Consider this for your home. But look how thin they are. It's really an amazing thing. And most Americans have not yet seen these, but they can make a huge difference. And what we have to do.
Yeah. I've always considered myself a futurist, but I'll tell you, Stan was so much further in the future than I ever was. Instead of making one deposition at a time, stopping and doing another deposition, we continuously go through the machine. And in the first chamber, we start to deposit some material. In the next chamber, we deposit another material, and so on until the end.
Standing in front of a machine producing solar material that's a football field long, understanding that miles of the material go in at one end and miles of thin film solar material come out at the other. This isn't science fiction. It is a manufacturing process and a science that can transform the world. Detroit is a city that is the symbol of the automobile industry, but also of U.S. industrial growth and preeminence in the 20th century. Henry Ford transformed the 20th century with two remarkably simple ideas, a moving assembly line and a car that was suited to mass production. Stan Ovshinsky does what Henry Ford did. He has created a technology that can harness the sun to meet social needs. But he goes really beyond Henry Ford in a pivotal way. He also developed the science that allowed new materials and new approaches in energy and information that lay the basis for this kind of a global transformation.
When visiting this factory where solar material is fabricated by the mile, one can find the uses of this material are very wide, especially for small communities, for large buildings where this solar material can improve and can save energy and make a much more efficient use of energy in every way.
Everybody seems to be talking about the hydrogen economy, but really, Stan actually built the company based on hydrogen. From the very first days in 1960, he knew that hydrogen would be part of the future of the world. We capture the sunlight with our photovoltaics. From that, we have electricity. We can break water into hydrogen and oxygen. We can capture the hydrogen storage system using a solid hydride. We can then feed that to a fuel cell to generate electricity. Or we can run the electricity directly to our nickel metal hydride battery, capture the electricity and store it there, and then release it in transportation products like electric and hybrid vehicles.
No car company will be able to thrive in the 21st century if it relies solely on internal combustion engines. Issues such as global climate warming, clean air, and energy conservation demand fundamental change from all industries and all nations.
Take our EV1 for an example. It's a nickel metal hydride battery that makes the EV1 the undisputed leader in range and performance of any electric vehicle in the world. Bob Stemple, Stan Ovshinsky, and Iris Ovshinsky certainly have been a close partner in this progress, and we're pleased that you're here today.
If you're going to change the world, you want to be realistic and practical, and you want to do something that will actually accomplish what you set out to do.
You can talk about hybrid cars, but every single electric car that was in the auto show in the last couple of years from the big three was on our batteries. Our batteries, our Ovonic nickel metal hydride batteries, are the enabling technology, is the enabling technology for making possible electric and hybrid vehicles. It isn't good enough to be an inventor. It isn't good enough to be an industrialist. It isn't good enough to be a technical person, to be a businessman. You have to combine all of these into a strategic vision that you can express.
What I saw yesterday with Stan and Bob is a pilot plant that blew me away. At some point, we've got to realize that you're going to have to face up to the new millennium for the young people is going to be an electric world. And you can quote that. I said that there will be an electric something in every garage within a year or two.
The reason I'm excited about the battery technology is that I know enough to know that there's serious economic issues with the fuel cell technology. So if we're going to move towards the use of hydrogen in transportation, it's got to be because we have a breakthrough in battery technology. It's clear to me that the techno-skeptics who really think that there's nothing on the drawing boards that's ready to go are wrong. There are ideas that we can put to work right now if we can have the right regulatory environment and the right public and private investment to drive it forward.
In Detroit, we saw a science and a technology that could change the world. It underscores the notion that our roadblocks to addressing these key issues are not technological. They're not the science. It's really the political will and the policy vision to get to them now.
We will restore science to its rightful place, and we will harness the sun and the winds and the soil to fuel our cars and run our factories. And we will transform our schools and colleges and universities to meet the demands of a new age. All this we can do. All this we will do.
I think that what everyone is looking for is signs of hope, signs of possibility that we can tackle the climate change problem successfully. A new American president, I think, has an opportunity to take these living examples of new technologies that offer tremendous promise and accelerate their commercial development, and that we can make a dent in our dependence on insecure sources of oil. What Stan's been working on, I think, is holding out that kind of a promise. He's demonstrated what's feasible, what's practical, and I'm quite encouraged about that. We're going to have a revolution in energy technologies, there's no question about it, and it won't just be in developed countries like the U.S., it's going to be in developing countries as well. And it'll be a mix of technologies, but what I saw in Detroit, I'll bet you dollars to donuts that it's going to be a big part of that mix.